In this characteristics, the first characteristic is fast convergence. Guys, you know what is a fast convergence, or what is a convergence in first place?
Like data and voice.
That like a collaboration you miss.
Right.
But convergence is different. Collaboration is means mixing different like a services, voice service and data service. That's a different thing. Voice, radio, like that.
Oh, yeah, right. Voice, radio.
But convergence is something different that we need in routing protocols. Sometimes we need a faster convergence. Sometimes we need a slower convergence. Most of the time we need faster convergence in case of IGP. Srijesh, any idea what is convergence?
No.
Okay, so convergence means, see, suppose my class is CCNA class. That's a daily class we have to conduct. So no problem, it's a daily routine. But suppose immediately my manager told me like before 10 minutes that today you have to take some other topic like security topics, network security. So I'm okay with that also. I can take network security. But he asked me to conduct a session on music or something very weird topic. Then it will be a difficult situation for me. You understand the point? Means the changes and how I'm adjusting with that changes. That's a convergence. Okay, so sooner I'll get a convergence on the changes, I'll be adjusted with that. Now let's take a technical example over this. This is like a very general example. So let's take this paint. So suppose we have a network. Router 1, R1, connected with R2, connected with R3, okay, and they are connected with a different network. Suppose here I have one network, here I have another network. So this X network is suppose down. So R3 know about that this particular network is down, but how that information will be updated to R2 and that information will be updated to R1. Okay. Now R1 and R2 both are trying to find another way to reach to this X network. Suppose we have another network, another router here, one more router, router 4. And it is also connected to the same network. Okay. The same network is connected via switch, something like that, to this R4, and our R1 router and R4 routers are connected to R4 as well. So suppose this is my high bandwidth link, 1 Mbps. This is also 1 Mbps link, and it's like a 256 kbps link. 256 kbps links. So we will consider this link when this primary link fails. So we have to start using R4 router to reach up to this network X. Okay, this network link is down. So we will reach to this network X from router 4. So it will take like 30 seconds to shift our traffic from R3 to R4. So this 30 seconds will be counted as what? My convergence time. This will be my convergence time. Okay. Suppose I'm using a faster protocol. Suppose this is the case with the RIP. Okay. And if I start using EIGRP, okay, so this convergence time will increase, will decrease to only like 1 second. Okay. Or OSPF like 2 seconds, like this. So faster it we change over to another available path. Faster means like our downtime will decrease in that case. So this smaller convergence time is the one that is the desired one in routing protocol. I hope this point is clear for you. Convergence time means what? how fast we can adjust the changes in our network, in short. Clear with this?
Yes.
Okay. Rashmi is also. Rashmi, you understood what this is, the convergence?
Yes.
Okay. So next point is scalability. So in case of RIP or in case of distance vector protocol, we have a limitation of network. How big we can have a network in case of RIP? What is the max hop count supported on RIP?
I believe 15.
Yeah, max is 15 and 16 consider invalid. So you cannot have more routers, or you cannot have like a thousands of routes in it. Okay, so scalability limitation we have in case of distance vector routing protocol, especially RIP routing protocol. So if you use replace that with EIGRP, the hop count increases to 100 by default, and you can increase beyond that as well. I have seen EIGRP implemented for 500 routers, so it can support like a thousands of routes and hundreds of routers. So big networks can be supported with EIGRP. Okay, so scalability is not an issue for EIGRP. We can have a big network, but still there is a problem with scalability on EIGRP also. The top means like the biggest networks in the world are running on OSPF. Okay, but still on enterprise business we can have EIGRP, and big networks can be supported on this. But ISP normally doesn't prefer EIGRP. ISP or data centers, they normally go with the OSPF. Enterprise level business can be supported over this. Okay. Load balancing or unequal cost link. So guys, what is load balancing?
Like shifted the data in different, balancing the
balancing the load over equal cost path. So yeah, last time we have seen this kind of example, like R1, R2, and R3, and network is like this: 192.168.1.0, 2.0, and 3.0. And we have a WAN link where 12.0.0.0 this network, and 23.0.0.0/8. And afterward I introduced two more network in this. I used as fast ethernet 0/0, and this is I used as fast ethernet 0/1. And I use a network like this: 172.16.1.0 network here, and here I use a network 172.16.2.0 network. Do you remember this topology? We used it for RIP version 1 and RIP version 2.
Yes.
And when we have a summarization, auto summarization by default enabled, so we were getting a update on the middle router as 172.16.0.0 with the /16 subnet mask. Okay, and one packet was going in this direction and one packet was going in this direction. When I gave the command ping 172.16.1.1, so one packet is correctly destined to the R1 router, and the second packet goes to the wrong direction and that got dropped. So this is called as equal cost load balancing. This is actually a wrong implementation we did, but suppose we have a scenario like this. Suppose R2 is connected to R1, and R2 is connected to R3 as well, and they both are connected to one switch like this. Okay, and this is like a 1 MB link here and 1 MB link here. So this will be equal cost load balancing. And in case of RIP, we will have a one hop over this, one hop over this, and this will be equal cost of load balancing. Suppose the same network we have to reach. Suppose this network is 172.16.1.0. So we can reach to the network correctly. And load balancing will also happen. One packet will go through R1 direction, one packet will go through R3 direction. What if I change the bandwidth? Suppose R1 bandwidth is increased to 2 Mbps and R2 to R3 bandwidth is still 1 Mbps. Then what will happen? Will it be an equal cost or unequal cost?
Unequal.
Unequal. And in routing table, if I run show IP route here, show IP route command on route R2, what will be the output of that for this particular route? The next stop will be R1 or next stop will be R3 or both will be there?
R1 because
we have a bandwidth, higher bandwidth. If it is a RIP, then the equal cost will be there. But if it is a EIGRP, if it is a EIGRP or OSPF, only this will be considered. Because RIP is just going to consider your hop count. So hop count is equal only. But if you have a EIGRP or OSPF, their bandwidth is more important. So bandwidth will be higher in R1 case, and this only this path will be considered and this path will not be considered. Clear with this, guys? Okay, this will be the situation, and this called as unequal cost. Okay, but in that case, I can't use this particular link, right? It is like a one unused link. I can use it when failover happens. Suppose this link goes down, in that case I will be able to take advantage of R2 to R3 link and reach to this network. Clear with this? But what if I want to utilize the second link as well and the first link as well? In that case, I have to use unequal cost load balancing. So in EIGRP, we have a function called as variance function. With the help of variance function, we can do that. I'll show you the command how the variance can be enabled. Understood the concept? What is the unequal cost of load balancing? And this feature is available only in EIGRP, neither in RIP nor in OSPF, but this feature is available in only EIGRP. So that is one of the advantage of EIGRP. Clear with this, guys? You understood this overall concept, what is unequal cost of load balancing?
Yes.
Okay, we will have more clarity on this when we will do a practical, or when we will do it with one particular scenario. So I'll show you the command as well on that. And next we have classless support. So EIGRP is a classless routing protocol, not a classful routing protocol, and because of that we can have a support to variable length subnet mask. So we can have /24, we can have a different subnet mask support. RIP version 2 is also classless. RIP version 1 is the only protocol that creates a problem for us, because that's a classful routing protocol. Okay, and EIGRP works on the multicast IP addresses. So what exact multicast IP address is being used there, we'll do a cross check on the simulation mode. Okay, that time I'll show you what exact multicast IP address is used. And it was a Cisco proprietary. Nowadays it is not a Cisco proprietary. Cisco has given a rights to any other vendor who wants to implement EIGRP in their devices. Like if Juniper wants to implement EIGRP, that's possible. They can implement it in their routing devices. Okay, if any firewall wants to get this routing protocol implemented in that, like a checkpoint firewall or Palo Alto firewall, they can do that. But I have seen so far no other vendor, big vendor, has given support for EIGRP. Okay, so neither Juniper, Palo Alto, also the firewall, I have not seen EIGRP is implemented there. So this is still one of the big disadvantage for EIGRP. EIGRP is still not used in other vendors. What impact it can give this feature on a routing protocol? Means overall implementation of routing. Guys, you understood my question. This is a means like in 2013 they have given rights, but still it is not implemented in Juniper. So if any company choose EIGRP as a routing protocol, what could go wrong with overall routing? Yes, ISP level network we don't use it because the scalability in ISP is very high end. So it's like a very big network we have to support. So in ISP we don't use. Even data center networks also, you may not see this in a data center network also. Only enterprise level network can support EIGRP. Any particular projects can be implemented in EIGRP. Okay. This means like for interaction with ISP, we are not using EIGRP or not even OSPF also. In that case, we use BGP. Either static routes or we use BGP. But we don't go for EIGRP or any IGP protocol in that case. If you want to do an interaction between ISP and your enterprise business, okay? ISP, I mean to say the internal network of ISP, if you want to implement, that IGP is... it should be OSPF, not the EIGRP. And here the main disadvantage is that if you stuck with EIGRP, suppose afterward it's like a Juniper routers are giving better features with less cost, but still you are using EIGRP, so you have to use only Cisco devices. So you are like a trapped in Cisco devices only. So this is the biggest disadvantage we have on EIGRP routing protocol. So that's why we in industry, most of them like a management policy is there that's called as vendor independent policy. We should not get any protocol or any technology which is dependent on any of the vendor. Okay. So that's why in industry it is not preferred. I hope this is clear for all of you. Few theoretical components are there on EIGRP. We have neighbor discovery process, RTP process, and RTP protocol is there, and dual algorithm is used, and protocol dependent module. Let me explain you these things. Neighbor discovery is just given one bullet point. Actually, in finding a best route in EIGRP, neighbor discovery is used. Means first, the behavior of EIGRP and RIP is totally different on this. See, it's, let me give one general example. See, if suppose three friends are there and they are doing a party, suppose they are all drunk, and one of the friend stand up and give the information about his friends and then sit down, the another friend stand up and gives information about himself and his friends and then sit down, then third friend stand up and give information about himself and then sit down, again the first friend stand up and give the same information. Every 30 seconds he is doing the same, all of them are doing the same task, and they are broadcasting their information to the rest of the two friends. So if only like two friends, three friends or five friends are there, this could be a bearable situation. But suppose we have a party where almost like hundreds of people are there, and if things are working like this, it will be a big chaos. We cannot work like this. So in this case of in this scenario, we need to form a like a people will find their like-minded people, and they will form a neighbor like a friendship with their friends, and they will have a discussion with them. Okay. So similarly, in a big network or in a big scale network, okay, large scale network, we have to implement EIGRP or OSPF, and they form a neighbor discovery. Means they cannot exchange the routes directly. They have to first form a neighbors, and then after forming a neighbor, they exchange their database, and from exchange database, they find the best route. Is it clear for you? This example is, it's like a somewhat matching with this. Shrijesh, you understood the point which I want to raise here?
Yes.
Okay. So this neighbor discovery is the first process in EIGRP. After that, they exchange the database with this protocol. It's called as RTP. This is layer 4 protocol, reliable transfer protocol, transport protocol. So in case of RIP, we were using UDP protocol as the layer 4 protocol, but in EIGRP, we are not using that layer 4 protocol as UDP. We are using this RTP protocol, reliable transport protocol, and we exchange the database from one router to another router. That is called as topology exchange. Okay, and whatever information we have on R1, that will get shared with the R2, and from that R2 will find out which route I will put in the routing table, so that best route will be collected from that and will be entered into or installed into routing table. Okay, so to see the neighbor, we have a command like this, show IP EIGRP neighbor. So that neighbor table will be exposed, and interfaces and topology can be exposed with the command show IP EIGRP interfaces and topology. That gives us the database of the EIGRP. Okay, and the routing table we can see easily with the command which we already know, show IP route. Okay, so these are the commands we will be helpful. We'll run this command afterward. And to find the best routes, or to find out the routes, we use this algorithm, diffused update algorithm. In EIGRP, we are using this algorithm. How it works, we'll talk about that. There are 4 components in this route algorithm that also we'll discuss. And it is protocol independent. What does it mean? It means that it can support IPv4 and it can support IPv6 as well. Okay. It's not specific to IPv4 only. Even it can support the older protocol like IPS, IPX that was used it's a older protocol actually. In novel network operating system, we were using that protocol. Nowadays, this protocol, IPX protocol, is totally obsolete. And Apple Talk is also one of the layer 3 protocol that is also supported in EIGRP, but these protocols are trivial nowadays. We are not using this protocol at all. Only IPv4 we are using, and in some implementation we use IPv6 as well. Okay, so these protocols are supported. Okay, diffused update algorithm. So the full form is diffused update algorithm, and the keyword is like this, DUAL. You can see here. Okay, we'll talk about DUAL in a short while. There are a few more components in that. So we'll implement a small lab, and along with this lab, we will try to understand the timers and this diffused update algorithm, the topology, okay, and the routing tables. So I'll take one small lab for this, the lab which we are using for our practicals, 3 routers lab. Let me check any previous lab is available for us. static route is there. Any protocol is running here? I'm not sure about. So no protocol is running here. Mumbai. Static routes are there. Okay, so I use this for a default routing. On top of that, I'll implement EIGRPN. We'll see how it behaves for in combination with static routing and in combination with EIGRPN. Okay, so syntax also I'll explain, and the impact of that syntax also we'll discuss. So I'm entering into configuration mode. As of now, there is no protocol running on this. Okay. So command syntax goes like this: router EIGRP, and then we have to give autonomous system number. So this autonomous system number, whatever we are taking, it should be constant throughout all three routers. Delhi, Mumbai and Bangalore should all carry this autonomous system number. Guys, what is autonomous system number? From the name itself, we can understand its meaning. Autonomous means within our company, we can do anything. Like we can have a VLAN for this network, VLAN for that network. Whatever setup we want to implement, that's up to us. No one is dictating you that the network setup is like this, network setup should be like that. Means ISP will not impose any rules for you. It's your domain. You can use any private IP address. You can use 192 IP address. You can use 172 IP address. It's up to you. According to your requirement, you can use the routing protocol. According to your requirement, you can use addressing scheme, right? So that is the one autonomous system number. But whatever autonomous system number you are taking, that should be constant throughout all routers. Delhi, Mumbai, and Bangalore all should have same autonomous system number. So I'm taking autonomous system number one. And why it should be constant, there is one more reason that also I'll explain you. So when we form a neighbor relationship, these things should match. Authentication, if we have authentication, means password, if we are setting, that password should be matched, and autonomous system number should match. Okay, and K value should match. That we will discuss afterward. So first two things you can understand at this stage. If we are setting password on the EIGRP, that password on the neighboring router, means in our topology, you can see password between Delhi and Mumbai should be same. Then they will form a neighbor relationship. Furthermore, their autonomous system number should also be same. Otherwise, neighbor relationship will not form. Okay. And there are a few more things that should also match that we will discuss soon. Okay. So this is the significance of autonomous system number. Next, we will take the command here, network 192.168.1.0. And after that, we have to specify the wildcard bits. So the wildcard bits for this network will be like this: 0.0.0.255. Guys, you know what is wildcard bits and how it will be calculated? Let me explain you here. On the pent, I'll explain. So if we have a subnet mask like this, 255.255.255.0. This is my /24 subnet mask. I have to subtract it with this number. And this will become my wildcard bits. Okay. So this wildcard bits I have to enter in my network statement. Okay, so what will happen if I give this command? See in the output of simulation, just look for EIGRP packets. Once we enter this command, we are start sending EIGRP hello packets down this link. Okay, as of now we don't have any router down this switch, so these packets are getting discarded at the PC end because they don't understand this what they are speaking. Like Mumbai, when we enable the next statement on this 192.168.12.0, that time this particular interface will be coming under, or the EIGRP process will get enabled on this process, and hello packets will get sent from this particular interface. Let's do that now. So we'll implement one more statement now. This is for 12.0 network, okay, because the intermediate network between Delhi and Mumbai is this 12.0. Once we do that, we have one more EIGRP packet going from this Delhi and between Delhi and Mumbai. Okay, now let's try to explore this packet, what's there in that packet. So if you see here, okay, so this is my EIGRP packet. It contains autonomous system number, okay, K values are there, and authentication information is not there. K value we'll talk about afterward. Just you can look at the IP details. We have 224.0.0.10 as the destination IP address, and similarly we have a MAC address of 01005E00000A. What is A? Hex value A means decimal is what? 10, and same 10 value is here. Okay, so from your multicast IP address, multicast MAC address is also calculated, and when switch receives any multicast MAC address, it will get flooded on PC0 and PC1 or whatever devices are connected there. Okay, so these two information we can pay attention as of now, that destination IP address is also multicast IP address, and destination MAC address is also multicast MAC address. Okay, so this is the simplest way to enable a EIGRP on the interface. Okay, so now if I run the command show IP protocol, you may see now 192.168.1.0 and 192.168.12.0. These two statements have entered. Okay, let's run one more command, show IP EIGRP neighbor. So as of now, I am sending these messages to the adjacent router or adjacent computer, but no one is replying back because they are not running with this EIGRP process. So I have to run this command on Mumbai router as well. So let me run this on Mumbai router now. Configuration mode, same command I'll execute, router EIGRP 1 network. So I have three network, 192.168.12.0, I have 192.168.2.0, and I have 192.168.23.0. if I give this statement like this, 192.168.0.0 with the wildcard bits of 0.0.255.255, and I form a neighbor relationship with a Delhi router. Okay, so guys, you understood this statement, network 192.168.0.0 and the wildcard bit is 0.0.255.255. What this 0 means and what this 255 means in wildcard bits? See, 0 means here is it should match, and 255 means what? Ignore. Okay, so when I give this statement, what does it mean? First octet should be 192 and second octet should be 168. What is third octet and what is fourth octet is immaterial, and we are going to ignore this. That's why in our topology, in three interfaces we have on Mumbai router, this interface and this interface. All these three interfaces have first and second octet as 192, 168. But the third octet keeps on changing. Here we have 12 and the IP address is 12.2. Here we have 2.1 as the IP address on the fast Ethernet interface, and serial 001 has 23.2. Okay. So first and second statement should match. First and second octet should match, and third and fourth octet ignored. Okay. This is how it can be interpreted. Clear with this, but it doesn't mean that we are advertising 192.168.0.0. See, this network statement and advertisement of the network is totally different things. So if I run command show IP neighbor, EIGRP neighbor, I should have one neighbor form. Neighbor. So you can see here, this is my zeroth neighbor, means the first neighbor, I mean to say. That's a 12.1. 12.1 is the IP address of my Delhi router. And this neighbor relationship has been formed on the interface serial 000. Okay. Since 12 seconds, we have received the hello. It keeps on increasing, decreasing, I mean to say. 11, then again 14. Okay. There is a logic behind this hold down timer updating keeps on decreasing and up increasing that we will discuss soon. Okay, and since last 2 minutes and 26 seconds, this neighbor relationship is up. This is round trip time. This takes 40 milliseconds to send hello packets and receive a hello, means like a data is sent to that and received back. So it takes 40 milliseconds. Sequence number, we don't have any changes so far. So last change or last update we have received is like a sequence number 5, and whenever new update will come from that router, that sequence number will increase. We don't have any query message on that. Okay, RTO I'll explain you afterward. Okay, so this is like a show IP EIGRP deed information. Okay, and routing table, if I see here now on Delhi router, so it will be bit changed now. Show IP route. So I have few EIGRP routes entered or installed in my routing table. Okay, how these routing tables are installed, how these routes are installed in routing table. What process we have seen in our document? First, the neighbor relationship will be formed. Okay. Second, whatever statement we are giving on the router EIGRP process, those routes will get installed into routing, into topology table, means database. That database is like this, show IP EIGRP topology. So I have these routes 192.168.1.0, but that's a connected one. Okay, I have another route 192.168.2.0 that I'm receiving from the adjacent router, that's a Mumbai router. 12.0 is the connected one. Okay, and 23.0 I'm receiving it from the adjacent router, that is the Mumbai router. Okay, so this database I have built up. We will interpret what is this FD and what this first value means and what is this second value means, that we will discuss soon. But this is overall the database. From this database, our routing table is built up. Okay, but in case of Mumbai router, this database is there. If you see show IP EIGRP topology, this database is there. But if you see the routing table, show IP route, no EIGRP routes are installed in the routing table. It is there in the database, but it is not installed in routing table. Guys, are you able to figure out the reason why we are not seeing any EIGRP routes in our routing table of Mumbai router, whereas we are able to see the same thing in the Delhi router. What is the reason we are not able to see this routing table, routing entries in routing table of Mumbai router? Static route. Yes, Rijesh, it is a static route. Because of static route, we are not able to see the EIGRP routes. But what exact reason is there? Correct. Metric value will come afterward. First, what is this? This is not a metric value. Metric value is zero in static route. Okay. This is something different. It's not a metric value. It's something different. Madhu, Rashmi, are you able to figure out this reason of why we are not able to see EIGRP routes?
AD value.
Correct. AD value. Because here in static route, we have AD value of 1. Whereas EIGRP, if you check on Delhi router, let's check because these routes are visible there. What is the AD value here? 90. So if you have any particular routes available with the AD value of 90 and any particular routes, same particular route is available with the AD value of 1, which will be preferred? Obviously the AD value 1 is preferred. So that's why the static routes cannot be replaced by EIGRP. So if you have a comparison, like EIGRP is also running and static routes are also running, we will not be able to see the EIGRP routes in that. Clear with this? Let's cross check this thing. What I'll do, I'll remove the static route from my routing table. IP route 192.168.1.0. Subnet mask is 255.0. And the next stop is 192.168.12.1. You can see here, this is my next stop. And this is my network, and this is my network, and this is my subnet mask. Okay, and I'm going to cancel this route. So control A, no, remote. What it says? Okay, next stop accidentally or by mistake I given 12.0. It should be 12.1. Now it's been removed. Now let's check show IP route. Correct. Yes, Rijesh. So guys, are you able to now understand the change here? 1.0 immediately replaced by EIGRP route instead of static route, because we lost the static route. Now we have 1.0 available via EIGRP. Clear with this? Any doubts so far, guys? Okay. So same thing, 3.0 also we can do, but 3.0 is not advertised in show IP EIGRP topology table. I don't have 3.0 available. I have 1.0 available, 12.0, 23.0, 2.0, but 3.0 yet not available. Okay, so let it get first entered into EIGRP topology table, and then we will replace the static routes. Okay, and one more thing from this you can observe. See, guys, we have a static route here, but that static route does not stop us to enter this route. Any reason? We have a static route here also in Delhi router. That's a default static route. But still we are entering or we are installing 192.168.2.0 via EIGRP. How it is possible? Here I have a AD value of 1 and here I have a AD value of 90. Still, these routes are also there and these routes are also there. What is the reason? Madhup, Rashmi, Shijesh, you understood my question. We have a static route, default static route, and we have a EIGRP. How they are coexisting? Why my static route, if my static route is available, EIGRP is still there? Hello?
Specific routes are initiated.
Right. Specific routes are more preferred as compared to default routes. Default route will be considered at last resort. We will not take it initially. That's why this particular route is still there. Okay. If we have a default route, that will be there, but it will be considered at the last resort. That's why it is written as last resort. So this is also one of the important point that we need to understand. When we have a specific route, that will always be preferred. Okay. And let's implement it on Bangalore. Guys, I'm going to implement it with little different approach now. See, on Bangalore, router EIGRP 1 network 192.168.23.1, because the IP address of this interface is 1 and I'm going to give the wildcard bits like this 0.0.0.0. So what does it mean? What the 0 stands for in our discussion we discussed? 0 means match. Okay, so all these 4 octets should exactly match. So in this topology, 192.168.23.1 means all should match. Okay, and we form the neighbor relationship. Okay, next, similarly, I'll take one more network. So 3.1, this network I entered. Okay, so that matches with this. Okay, so suppose after doing this, if I change the IP address of F0/0. Okay. Right now it is in the topology table. If I show you, I show IP EIGRP topology. So it is there in the database. This 3.0 network is also there and 23.0 network is also there. Actually, I entered the command 192.168.23.1, but the network which we are advertising now is 192.168.23.0. Okay. Now let's do one thing. We'll go to interface F0/0 and I'll give IP address. I'm going to change the IP address now. 192.168.3.100. See what impact it's going to put now. My 3.0 network has been removed now. I have 192.168.1.0, 2.0, but 3.0 network is no longer available. If you run the show IP EIGRP protocol command, my statement is what? 192.168.3.1. Do I have any interface as a 3.1? I have a 3.100 here and my statement is 3.1. So it's not matching with this. That's why in topology table, I don't have any entry for 3.0 network. Clear with this?
Samir, one question, Samir.
Yes.
Actually, in EIGRP, we are putting 192.168.3.1 is a IP address, right?
Huh.
How it's take a network from that IP address?
This statement we are given, no?
Yes.
Okay. So it will look for any interface who has this IP address 192.168.3.1.
Okay.
Okay. And if any IP address is available as 3.1, it will enable EIGRP process on that.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And will start entering that route into my EIGRP topology database.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then that will be advertised to the Mumbai router. This is the sequence. No,
actually, my question is how it take that networks.
Means like a 0.0.0.0.
Yes. Yes.
See.
No. No. 0.0.0. Means 192.168.3.1 is same for that EIGRP, right?
Zero means
we are providing that network, not IP address.
Yes, we are trying to match, means if any interface is there with the IP address 3.1, only that case we will implement EIGRP on that. Okay, if you don't have any interface with 3.1 IP address, we will not implement EIGRP on that. This is the meaning of this command.
Hmm.
Okay, because we are taking /32 subnet mask and 0.0.0.0 as a wildcard bits. Okay, so exact match should happen there. So yeah. It's the simplest implementation will be like this. This is the most loose implementation, and this is the most strict implementation. Why I'm saying
so it is taking from that interface, or it is taking that network into that interface, or
yeah, whatever IP addresses we have on the interfaces, if it is matching with 3.1, we will implement it. Okay, and in this statement, what we are saying, take any interface, take any IP address, just advertise it in the EIGRP topology.
Hmm.
Okay, so that's why I'm saying loose implementation and I'm saying strict implementation.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so if I want to do this in our case now, it should be like this. Okay, because we have a 3.100 IP address on the interface, not 3.1. Okay, so whatever network we have on this particular interface, once in our topology, it will enable this EIGRP process will get enabled on fast Ethernet 0/0. And whatever network we have on this interface, that will get advertised into topology first. And from topology, it will be advertised to the Mumbai router. Then from topology table of Bangalore router, it will go to topology table of Mumbai router. And Mumbai router will install it first into the topology table, EIGRP topology table. And it will check, can I have a better route from EIGRP and that I can install in my routing table? So see, in Mumbai router, we have a static routes already available like this. So that will not replace the EIGRP topology tables entry. So we have an entry of 3.0 available here, but that will not replace the static route. That reason we already understood that we have an AD value better here in static. That's why it is not getting replaced. If I remove that from here, then it will be possible. So if I change like this 23.1 and this should be 3.0. So this route is now removed from the static route. Now it is there in topology table as well as it is there in the routing table as well. Clear this point? I hope this clear all your doubts. Where we are. This is one of the point. Source IP address used by neighbor's hello must be in the same subnet as the local router's interface IP address and mask. What does it mean? when Delhi router send hello packets to Mumbai and Mumbai router send hello packets to Delhi, they will look for the source IP address. So when Delhi router send hello packets to Mumbai, the source IP address is what? 192.168.12.1, and it is destined for what? Multicast IP address 224.0.0.10. But source IP address is 192.168.12.1. So that IP address and Mumbai router's interface IP address should have same subnet or should have same network. So what is their common network? 192.168.12.0. In that case only this neighbor relationship will form. Suppose I have something different IP address here and they are sending hello packets with some different IP addresses. That case neighbor relationship will not form. Okay. So this is the third point in this. If authentication is there, that should match. If we are autonomous, we have autonomous systems, that should also match. And this network of the hello packets should fall in this, means like source IP address of the hello packet must match with the router's interface IP address. Is this point clear for you, or should I run a simulation to explain you in the more detail of this? And last thing in this is K value, for that we need to understand the metric for EIGRP that we'll discuss after understanding the metric. Okay. And we have the hello time and hold down time of 5 seconds and 15 seconds. Let me show you that as well. So if I go on Delhi router, and if I run the command show IP EIGRP interface, this will not give the details. This command is not supported on packet tracer. Show IP EIGRP interfaces, or any other means we have, show IP protocol. So timers are not exposed here. Okay, tomorrow I'll show you on the GNS or UNL where I can show you this command, show IP EIGRP interface detail. There we can see this. Okay. So the timer here is 5 seconds and 15 seconds. 5 seconds is hello time and 15 seconds is the dead time or the hold down time. Okay. And that we can observe in this command. Show IP EIGRP neighbor. So this goes up to 10 seconds and then 14, 11, 10. This guy's focus on this on hold down timer. See the pattern. 14, 13, 12, 11, 10. But we if you pay attention closely here, we are starting with 14. Actually, it is a 15. Actually, 15, 14, 7, 13, 12, 11, 10, max to max we drop down to 10 and not beyond that. So what does it mean? If you see in the diagram, so every 5 seconds we are sending hello packets. So this hold down timer is like a 15 second, 14 second, 13 second, 12 second, 11 second, 10 second, and again we receive one more hello packet from R1, and my hold down timer again reset to 15 second. Then the countdown again start 14 seconds, 13 seconds, 12 seconds, 11 seconds, 10 seconds, and then again we will receive one more hold down time. clear with this? That's how we can interpret here. This is the command. If you run it on a real device or on the UNL or GNS, then we can run this. Okay, show IP IGRP interface. Here, hello time is also there and hold down time is also there. It's not required here. Next process is understanding of this dual diffused update algorithm. So guys, you can enter if you observe this diagram, you can come to the conclusion that this R3 has two neighbor. One is R1, the other one is R2. Means we can reach to 10.1.1.0 network via R1. We can reach to 10.1.1.0 network via R2. Okay, and suppose they are on the same segment, means this particular network is on the same segment. Suppose here we have switch, that switch is connected to R1, that switch is again connected to R2. Okay, so if we go via R1 and R2, means R2, R1 both has a cost, or the means like a cost to reach to this network is like 1000, and R3 and R1 are connected with serial link, means low bandwidth link, and R3 and R2 is connected with the high bandwidth link. Suppose it is the Ethernet connection. So here we have a cost of 5000 and here we have a cost of 10000. So if you prefer which path we should go, always we will prefer the R2. Okay, so this particular number is called as advertised number, and the total distance to reach to this particular network is called as feasible distance. Take an example, like I have two friends, friend one and friend two, and I have to reach to airport. So if I go via friend one, means friend one is also, means friend one is saying to reach to airport I have to spend 1000 rupees, and friend two is also saying to reach to airport I have to spend 1000 rupees. Means that friend has to spend 1000 rupees. But to reach to friend's house, R1, the first friend's house, I have to spend 10,000 rupees. And to reach to the second friend's house, I have to spend only 5,000 rupees. So better I'll go with the second friend. Okay. So it will take less amount to reach to the airport via R2 or via second friend. So it's called as advertised distance, means how much cost we have to reach to this network and what is the cost to reach to R2. Okay, so the total distance will be considered as feasible distance. Okay, that's what it is listed in the table also. So we will consider this R2 as a successor route. Okay, means best route, you can say successful route, and we can consider R1 as a feasible successor provided a feasibility condition is fulfilled. So what is feasibility condition? Feasibility condition is that the second route, means R1 is a second route because the best route is R2 as per our topology. Okay, and R1 can be considered as a feasible successor or backup route if this condition is qualified. What is the condition? Advertised distance of additional route, means R1. What is the additional distance of this R1? 1000. Should be less than feasible distance of the successor, means 1000 is less than 6000. That's true. So we can consider R1 as a feasible successor. This is the most important concept in EIGRP, and it is used for loop avoidance. Guys, you understood this point? What is a feasibility condition?
Yes.
Okay. Shrijesh, you understood this point? Rashmi, any doubt in this? Please ask, or else we will move ahead. Okay. Okay. Now we need to understand the metric calculation in EIGRP. So we have five parameters in metric calculation, but I mark two parameter as a red one. That's only used in metric calculation. The rest of the three parameters, load, MTU, and reliability, will get zeroed out. The reason for that is they have a formula with multiplier, and the multiplier is zero for reliability, MTU, and load. And only bandwidth and delay multiplier has a K1 one value of one, and K3 has a value of one. You can see this exact formula is like this: K1 multiplied with bandwidth and K3 multiplied with delay, and rest of the parameter will get zeroed out because they are having a multiplier of zero. And bandwidth, we don't consider the high bandwidth, we consider here the low bandwidth. So take an example here in our diagram. If R1 has to reach to 192.168 at 1.0, we have to consider a serial link, WAN link, and we have to consider this fast Ethernet LAN link. So serial link has a speed of 1.54 Mbps, and this LAN link has a speed of 100 Mbps. But in formula, 1544 kbps is installed, means the least bandwidth is considered. Okay, and second thing we have to consider the delay. So delay will be cumulative delay, means additional delay, means we have to add the delay of serial link and we have to add the delay of this LAN link or Ethernet link. So here we have a delay of 20,000 in serial link, and we have a delay of 100 microsecond. Here we have a 20,000 microsecond delay, and here we have a 100 microsecond delay on this interface. Okay, and that will be added into the formula, divided by 10, and from there we will have a value from this metric. In book also it is mentioned like this. Exact formula you can refer: 10 raised to 7 divided by least bandwidth plus cumulative delay, okay, multiplied by 256. So whatever number we can get from that, it goes into lakhs actually. Why they means like a bounce this value to a large number, I don't know, but that's how they designed it. Okay, I hope this formula information is clear for you. No one asked in interview about this exact formula, so don't get worried about the exact formula. You just have to remember that two things are there in the formula. One is bandwidth, least bandwidth, and other one is delay. Okay, because the multipliers are K1 and K3 is equal to 1, rest all are 0. How we can find out the bandwidth and delay EFT? Just give me a minute, I'll complete this in a flow, then I'll again come back for AD and FT. So the bandwidth can be find out from this show interface. If you run it for any of the interface, you will get the bandwidth there and the delay value also. Okay, Shrijesh, this AD and FD can be calculated like this. See, so AD value and the FD value. Let me show you the AD value and FD value in our topology. So let's go to our scenario here. So if Mumbai has connectivity, Mumbai router has connectivity to 192.168.2.0. So to reach to this network, the AD value, this particular value will be very less. You can see here. How we can get that? That value is there in the topology table. Show IP EIGRP topology. Which network is directly connected to Mumbai? 192.168.2.0. You can see here. I want EIGRP topology. So this topology values is here. What is the feasible distance here? 28,168. Clear? So this is the value, or this is the cost we need to reach to 192.168.2.0 from Mumbai router. Is it clear? This is a feasible distance, or this is the distance to reach to 192.168.2.0. Okay. Now, it is directly connected to Mumbai. So obviously Mumbai is going to advertise these routes to Delhi, right? So Mumbai will advertise 192.168.2.0 with the advertised distance or AD value of 28,160. Okay.
Okay.
Let me cross check that on the Delhi router. Is it true or false? Let's check. Okay. Let's check in the topology table. Show IP EIGRP topology. So let's look for this network 192.168.2.0. Do we have that route? Yes, we have that route. And who is advertising that route? That route is advertised by Mumbai router because the IP address is 12.2. Clear? And what is the advertised distance for that? 28,160. The same number which we have collected in the Mumbai router. Clear with this? This is the advertised distance.
Okay.
Okay. Now, this is about a LAN link. So that's why the cost is in the 28,000. But this WAN link has very high cost. This is because this is serial link. Bandwidth is very less in this case, 1.54 Mbps. That's why the feasibility distance is 21,72,416. That include your cost to reach to Mumbai router plus 28,160. Whereas Mumbai router is not required any additional serial link cost because that's directly connected. In this directly connected routes, do you see anything like feasible distance and advertised distance like this? Two numbers are not there. This first number, this number, the smaller number is advertised distance, and this number is what? Feasible distance. Means 21 means it's, if you take the numbers little lower, like a 10,000 I require to reach to Mumbai, and Mumbai just require 1,000 to reach here. So total cost will be 10,000 plus 1,000. Feasible distance will be 11,000 to reach to 192.168.2.0. Whereas Mumbai will advertise it to rest of the router that I need a 1,000 to reach to 192.168.2.0. Is this point clear?
Yeah.
Okay. Let's move ahead then. Same thing I listed in document also. And we can manipulate these K values, but be careful. If we manipulate this K value, your neighbor relationship will tear down. And you will get a message like this, K value mismatch. What is the reason for this? If you put this topology in a simulation mode, and if you see the hello packets which are going from one router to another router, let's check this one. It is coming from Delhi router. We have a K1, K2, K3, K4, K5. So K1 has a hex value 1 and K2 has a hex value 0, right? K3 has a hex value 1, K4 has a hex value 0, K5 has a hex value 0. So only K1 and K3 has a hex value 1. If you change this K value, this hello packet will get mismatched. Okay. And neighbor relationship will get teared down. Okay. So autonomous system number is there and the k values are there mentioned in the hello packets. Okay, so if it is mismatched, then the neighbor relationship will tear down. For feasibility condition, I have taken one more scenario here. Like, we have a network beyond R5, and to reach to that network, we have R2 as a best path, because advertised distance here is 5000 plus 1000 to reach here to one particular network. So R2 is advertising that I need 6000 to reach to this network. Okay, whereas R3 is advertising I need 11000 to reach to that particular network. That's why they become successor and feasible successor, whereas R4 is not feasible successor. Reason, we have a advertised distance or reported distance as 18,000, and 18,000 is not less than the feasible distance of the successor. That's why this R4 cannot be considered as a feasible successor. Okay, so guys, give me an answer for this question. If R2 goes down, what will happen? Immediately R3 will take place, right?
Right.
But what will be the situation with R4? Will R4 become feasible successor?
Yes.
But that feasibility condition, will it be fulfilled?
No.
Because 18,000 is not less than 18,000. They are equal, but not less. That's why feasibility condition still not fulfilled. So we cannot consider R4 as a feasible successor. Are you clear with this?
Yes, yes.
But what if this R3 also goes down? Can't we use R4 to reach to this particular network? According to the diagram, you can see we can reach, right?
Right.
So, but we are not going to do it immediate basis. What we will do, we will generate a query packet for, suppose we have a network X here. We will generate a query packet from R1 that will reach to R4. R4 will give a reply packet, and R1 will give a acknowledgement that this is okay for us, and now we will go here. It's like it's too costlier. We will not use it unless and until we lost the connectivity with the R2 and R3. Then we will, as a last resort, we means if you don't have any option, then we will go with R4. But it will take time with the query and reply messages. Whereas R2 to R3 transition will be very fast, because it's considered as a feasible successor. So immediately we will transition. Query reply not required in that case. Okay. So what is a query and reply messages? Let me show you. See, if we have one particular network, 1.1.1.0, and that network we have a direct connection. Suppose R2 is connected to that switch and R1 is also connected to that switch, so we have a connection to R1. But suppose we lost the connection to that particular switch, so we will start sending query messages to R2 and R3. Okay, R2 will also give reply and R3 will also give a reply. But R3 will give a reply with the infinite matrix that I don't have reachability to 1.1.1.0. Whereas R2 will give a reach information that advertised distance is so and so, and I can reach there. So that information will be collected at R1, and R1 will give an acknowledgement message. Okay, so we can reach there. It's like if you don't know, you have to give information that I don't have reachability to that particular network. What is the infinite matrix? I'll show you in a short while. Okay, but these are the different messages that flows in between. So let me show you: query, reply, acknowledgement, and before that we have a messages like hello message and update message. Hello message goes frequently on 5 second time span. Update message is on the initial condition only, means whenever we form a neighbor relationship, first time they send update messages, full updates. And once we have update, then we don't send the update every 30 seconds like RIP. Okay, only in case we have change in the network, that time partial update will go. Okay, and that partial update will be given to the another router. So these are the different packet we have in EIGRP. Okay. Let me show you the infinite matrix that we have in EIGRP. Tableau format we have. So here you can see the comparison between all three protocol, RIP, EIGRP, and OSPF. So metric is based on bandwidth delay. Full updates is sent on RIP version 2, but EIGRP periodic updates are not there. Okay, periodic hello messages are there in EIGRP. OSPF also send hello messages, and split horizon is there in RIP and EIGRP. Root poisoning is also there in the RIP and EIGRP, and we have this multicast IP addresses. Okay, and 16 is the hop count for infinite matrix, and for EIGRP we have 2^32 minus 1 as the infinite matrix. Okay, so when root poisoning has to be done, they send this 2^32 minus 1, or when we don't have reachability to one particular network and query packet hits, so infinite matrix can be replied back. Okay, OSPF has 2^24 minus 1. Okay, so the big number, this infinite matrix is very big number. Okay, a few more advanced points are there that we need to discuss here. If we implement a multi-access network, non-broadcast multi-access network like frame relay switch, okay, WAN link also is on the frame relay switch, that time we have to implement this command, means no IP split horizon EIGRP. What is the reason to implement this? Let me explain you here. See, branch one has a connectivity to headquarter, and branch 2 is also having connectivity to headquarter. So we have to have a neighbor relationship from headquarter to branch 1 and headquarter to branch 2. So if any network or any update is there from branch 1, that first will get conveyed to headquarter, and that same information will be relayed back to branch 2, provided split horizon function should not be implemented. What is split horizon? If any update is coming on particular interface, that same interface should not give the same update back to the another interface. So we have same interface, the serial 000. An update is coming from BR1 on this interface. Same update will not go back or relayed back on serial 1/0. In split horizon, it will not be allowed. So we have to disable the split horizon in that case. Okay. We can implement EIGRP on MPLS. So L3 MPLS VPNs are there and L2 MPLS VPNs are there. So in L3 MPLS VPN, we have to form this neighbor relationship with the edge level switch routers. Okay. And from that point onward, the packet will move with the label switching. So these internal routers of service providers are called as label switch router, and the edge device is called as edge level switch router, and this is our customer premises equipment. So you have to form a neighbor relationship with this edge level switch router, and from that point onward, packet will move with the label switching, and it will reach to the destination edge level switch router, and then it will exit out to the customer premises equipment. So this is how we can have an implementation on MPLS network. There are two MPLS implementation. One is layer 2 and one is layer 3. If it is layer 2, then you don't have to form a neighbor relationship with edge device of service provider. In that case, it will act as a one big switch. Okay, and you have a connectivity to your network, means this this CPE device can form directly neighbor relationship with this CPE device. You don't have to form a neighbor relationship with the edge label switch router. Direct neighbor relationship will be formed from this route, from this router to this router. Okay, that is L2 VPN and this is L3 VPN. We can have a metro Ethernet connections. In metro Ethernet connection, suppose we have a branches in three different location in Bangalore. One is like a HSR layout where our office is there. One is some suppose Electronic City. The other one is some other location like Whitefield. So they are all connected with service providers network. But for us, it will be one big switch. Okay, and we will treat it as a one LAN switch, but it is not actually LAN switch. This is metro Ethernet connection. Okay, so there also normal connections. Then we can use a multicast IP address also to form a neighbor relationship. A few more points are there, like passive interface. Okay, that I'll discuss in tomorrow's session, and a few more points are there to discuss this EIGRP, and it will take hardly 20 minutes that we finish up, and then we'll move toward OSPF discussion. Okay. Authentication is also there. I believe. Let me check in the scope. I guess authentication and few more points are there. So authentication and manual summarization, filtering, redistribution stuff, this point are not there. But I'll show you the commands. I'll not execute the authentication, but I'll show you the exact means like how we can implement it. And summarization part also I'll explain you tomorrow. That is not in the scope actually, manual summarization, but summarization in short, what is manual summarization? I have one slide for that. I'll explain you that, and then we'll finish our discussion on EIGRP, and then we'll move to the OSPF part. Okay guys, I'm done with my today's topic. Rest of the points we'll cover up in the next session. Any doubts so far?
No, not yet.
Okay, do this practical. If you come up with any doubts, keep me posted on that. Doubts tomorrow we will have a discussion. Yes sir,
I have one doubt. Actually I have one doubt in our either channel.
Yeah, either channel. You so
I forwarded that mail also.
Yeah I forgot to discuss that. Let me quickly explain on that. Control
either channel load balancing, and how about our port security aging time?
I told you aging time is used as a backup mechanism. We can use a recovery mechanism or we can use the aging time mechanism. Let me explain you there. Suppose we have, first I'll explain you about the aging time.
No, actually you told me to check in a real device, then only you can confirm.
No, it's same as that actually. Real devices I have not cross checked yet, but the concept is like this. See, if we have this device with the port security, and suppose the MAC address is A here, okay, and we have registered that MAC address or entered that MAC address here on the port number 1, okay, and someone did a mischief or by accident they replaced this cable and connected it here, and they replaced this, and the MAC address is B. Okay, so violation has been done, right? Once a violation has been done, this port goes into shutdown state, because by default shutdown is the violation mode, right? But we have to give shutdown and no shutdown command to recover back that port, right?
Yes.
So this is a manual process. Automatic process is what we will put aging time of 2 minutes. Mm-hmm. Okay. So if accidentally someone did this and they again connected back this port to the original PC, which has a MAC address of A. So after 2 minutes, this port will get recovered.
Mm-hmm.
So this is the concept of aging time.
So I can connect to B also.
You can connect B, but that B will not allow the connection. It will again go into shutdown if you connect B back. Only A will be allowed. Okay. And once we connect it to A, still, if you have not configured aging time, you have to give shutdown and no shutdown command. But if you have given aging time command, your legitimate PC will recover that port after 2 minutes.
Okay,
so this is the concept for that. And about ether channel. So suppose we have ether channel like this, and we have PC here. Suppose the PC 1 with the MAC address 1 and PC 2 with the MAC address 2. Okay. And here we have server. Okay, so and here I have a port number 1, port number 2. So these links will be considered, like for port number 1, the link number will be 0. And for port number 2, the link for port number 1, the link will be 0. And for port number 2, link will be 1. Link ID will be 1. It's called as link ID. Link ID. Okay. So when PC1 tried to send data, the means like a PC1 has a MAC address of 1. So at the end we have 1. Like this. So we will consider
this concept. I understood. No. In either channel, one command is there for load balancing. How it's apply on that interface?
Okay. See, if you want to change the load balancing, we can change the load balancing. That's possible. See, if suppose this switch is connected with router. All your traffic is coming through router. The MAC address of that router is suppose at the end we are having a MAC address 1 only. Means this number is 1, here also 1. So only link 1 is used, link 2 is never used. So this load balancing is not an optimal load balancing, right? So in that case, we have to use source MAC address and destination MAC address. Destination MAC address of the server and source MAC address of the router, then like a different links will be used. Suppose we have a server farm, so sometime we have to access one server, another time we have to access another server. So combination we are using. Okay. So one link will be used at one connection, the another link will be used at, so it keeps on changing the links, so load balancing will happen.
You mean to say load balancing is already enabled on this ether channel?
No, load balancing default is enabled, but that default is source MAC address only. This is the only source MAC address. And if it is not an optimal solution for your environment, it depends on the environment to environment. So I'm saying like if PCs are there, this could also be okay. But if routers are there and router is connected with and router is acting as a source MAC address, okay? Because if it's like inbound traffic, means if it is a data center router and these switches are there and then we have server farm, right? In that case, this source MAC address not is a optimum solution then. So it depends on the situation where we have to implement it. Okay. So different options are there. Source MAC address, combination of source IP address is also there. Okay. We have source and destination MAC address and source and destination IP address. Like these options are there. And if you go with the high end switches, I mean to say 6500 switches or 4500 switches, the high end switches can support the port number as well. Means TCP port or UDP port. That combination could also be possible. all platform are not supporting that. All platform will support this source destination source MAC address or destination MAC address or source IP address or destination IP address combination.
Okay.
We have a practical for this in a CCNP level. That's why I'm not stressing this point more here.
Okay, Nash.
But I hope this clarify your doubts.
Yes.
Okay then. Okay then, guys, we'll close our session here. Rest of the point we'll cover in the tomorrow session. Good night.
Okay.
Good night. Bye.